Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating through our Trinity until this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and some other foreign countries. The Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we used to teach by the true and original names and title for the Father, the Word, Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been properly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been properly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, the shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple, yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach the divine pattern of the universe. Now, it's called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Now, after Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, He called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build it exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in this school to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. 10 primary constitution objectives or aims of this tour as follows. 1 is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. 2 is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3 is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. 4 is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. 5 is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. 6 to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. 7 is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And 8 is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And 9 is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10 is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, our slogan, speak the truth. We have a prayer tonight by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is Job, the 28th chapter. And our scripture reader would be Dr. Kenway Kleinsmith. And we'll have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for make possible to our guests get here in safe. And whatever the speaker has something to say tonight can edify our souls. We are in the late times. Make him say something, then we can go home and say, oh, that was a beautiful class, like all the time. I say all those things, and you only son named Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Yeah. see all the people from Florida and Southern California. I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, edited by A.B. Train of the Scripture Research Association, and republished by Yashua Promotions. Job 28. Surely there is a vein for the silver, and a place for gold where they refine it. Iron is taken out of the earth, and brass is molten out of the stone. He setteth them into darkness, and searcheth out to the limit, the stones of darkness, and the shadow of death. They sink a shaft far from the inhabited surface. They go down swinging to and fro, hanging by a rope, into the earth, for out of it cometh substance, and under its surface, turned up by blast. Among the stones of it lie sapphires and gold dust. There is a path which no fall knoweth, and which the vulture's eye hath not seen. The lion's whelps have not trodden it, nor the fierce lion passed by it. He putteth forth his hand upon the rock. He overturneth the mountains by the roots. He cutteth out canals amid the rocks, and his eye seeth every precious thing. He bindeth the floods from overflowing, and the thing that is hid bringeth he forth to light. But where shall wisdom be found, and where is the place of understanding? Man knoweth not the price thereof, neither is it found in the land of the living. The depth saith, it is not in me, and the sea saith, it is not with me. It cannot be gotten for gold, neither shall silver be weighed for the price thereof. It cannot be valued with the gold of Ophir, with the precious onyx or the sapphire. The gold and the crystal cannot equal it, and the exchange of it shall not be for jewels of fine gold. No mention shall be made of coral or of pearls, for the price of wisdom is above rubies. The topaz of Ethiopia shall not equal it, neither shall it be valued with pure gold. Whence then cometh wisdom, and where is the place of understanding, seeing it is hid from the eyes of all living, and kept close from the fowls of the air? Destruction and death say we have heard the fame thereof with our ears. Elohim understandeth the way thereof, and he knoweth the place thereof. For he looketh to the ends of the earth, and seeth under the whole thing, to make the way for the winds, and he weigheth the waters by measure. When he made a decree for the rain, and a way for the lightning of the thunder, then did he see it, and declare it. He prepared it, yea, and searched it out. And unto man he said, Behold, the fear of Yahweh, that is wisdom, and to depart from evil is understanding. That was Job 28, let us all say,
Amen. Thank you for that. Right now we have Dr. Hemis Reisenkomm, our hospitality director. She will address our class to the visitors we have today.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It is really a pleasure this evening to introduce our visitors. I'm really happy to see you guys here. And it's so many Williams, so the names are really great. You know, just like Joe was saying, we have been on a roll with the Williams. First is Crystal and John Williams. And we have Nikki Johnson, Seth Williams, and Angel Williams. And we also have our returning guest and dean from Oceanside, Dr. Dennis Fopi. We're happy that you guys are here, and we hope you enjoy our class. And let's get it on.
Nervous tonight. Okay, our first speaker tonight from our Orlando, Florida branch school is Angel Williams.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
What a surprise.
You know what's going to happen.
Compliments.
Compliments.
It's definitely a pleasure to be here. Very thankful that Yahshua allowed us the opportunity to come and study with our brethren. We've been talking about getting out here, so I'm just thankful that he's allowed us to be here and to see your faces again. And we do send greetings from the Orlando branch. Okay, what a surprise. Okay, so what we are blessed to be a witness of is this great divine vision and revelation that was given to our founder in the year of 1931. And at the end of this age that we are in, Yahweh purposed to give a man a divine, stupendous, panoramic vision. And that is what we see around these charts.
That's right.
And he's allowed us to just understand a little bit about his purpose, pattern, and plan. Mm-hmm. And so we never want to take for granted when he allows us to come through the doors. If we are not near classes, we don't want to take for granted that there are brethren that are, you know, projecting these classes on the internet. Because mm-hmm. when Yahshua gave the founder in the year of 1931, June the 6th, this divine, stupendous, panoramic vision, Yahshua thundered in his heart and mind, man, what will you do with that I have shown you? And so the founder said, I don't know. I know not. So what Yahshua proceeded to do was to give him this stupendous divine vision again. And he thundered into the man's mind, man, what will you do with that I have shown you? And Dr. Kinley said, teach your people your will, Yahshua. And so this is not the concept of a man's mind. You know, we don't come up here to give our concept and opinion. And personally, I don't want to hear your concept and your opinion. And I hope that you don't want to hear my concept and opinion. We want to hear what thus saith Yahweh. And so let's get John 17:1. We're going to set this thing up. John 17:3. Just started the third verse.
John 17:3.
And where she's reading, this is our Savior. The night before he's to be crucified, before he's to go through this horrible death, burial, and resurrection. Go ahead and read.
And this is life eternal.
Yahshua is saying, this is life eternal. Now, before we came into this class, we had all kind of concepts about what life eternal was. We were in churches, some brethren were in temples, mosques, but we had all these type of concepts and opinions on what God was, what life eternal was. But we didn't even know that in our very Bible, the Savior of the world is declaring what life eternal is. Read.
And this is life eternal.
He said, this is life eternal. Can you please read it from the Holy Name Bible?
Yes.
Now, in this school, we'll read from any Bible. We always encourage the brethren, bring whatever Bible you have. And y'all know that down here now, they have hundreds of Bibles.
That's right.
But we'll take whatever translation you have, because this divine vision, the Bible is confirming the vision. See, yes, this is a Bible school, but we're teaching a divine vision and revelation given directly from the Creator. So we're reading from a Holy Name Bible, which the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research did not print this Bible.
Right.
An Italian Jew printed the Bible.
Right.
And we're blessed to have brethren that have a company to reprint, but we didn't come up with this version of the Bible. We read from the Holy Name Bible, and we'll read from the King James. But this particular, right now, if you can read it from the Holy Name version.
And this is life eternal.
Yahshua was saying, and this is life eternal, read.
That they might know that.
That means anybody. That they might know.
That thou only art the true El. Thou only art the true El.
That you, Father.
That's right.
You, yeah. Yahweh. You are the only true El.
And Yahshua the Messiah.
And you are, not only are you the only true El, but you are Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent. That's life eternal to our soul, to know that Yahweh is the only true Elohim and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou hast sent. Keep reading.
I have glorified thee on the earth.
See, now while Yahshua was walking around on this earth, you know, the Christian world says that he was coming to set up a Christian example or a way of life. But Yahshua was coming to fulfill, and we didn't know that that was right in our Bible. It took the Holy Spirit to point that out to us. Read.
I glorified you on the earth.
And when you read the testimonies, Yahshua was just giving glory to the Father. Giving glory to the Father. Glorifying his name. He wasn't glorifying himself. He could have. Because what we just read, that he was Yahweh. But he was giving glory to the Father. He said, I have glorified thee on the earth.
I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do.
He finished some work? Read.
I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do.
Yes.
And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self.
Yes.
With the glory which I had with thee before the world
before
was.
Before the world was. Yahshua. Yahweh Elohim Yahshua. He had that glory before the world was. Y'all, these are mysteries that Yahshua has illuminated our hearts and minds with, because we didn't have no clue about this. Let's get Romans 1 and 19. Now, Romans 1 and 19, that's the theme song for the school.
Romans 1 and 19.
Read.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
So now you can know something about Yahweh. We can know something about God before we die, because in the religious world, they'll tell you, you can't know anything about God. It'll be revealed after you die. Ladies and gentlemen, it is too late. Right in our very Bible, you can know something. Because that which may be known
of Yahweh is manifest in them.
It's manifest in them. It was manifest in them back there, and it's manifest in us right now.
That's right.
Tonight,
read. For Yahweh has shown it unto them.
He's shown it. Read. Oh my goodness.
For the invisible things of him.
Yes. The invisible things of Yahweh. See, man, you come up here, you start sounding like you smart. We ain't know any of this. Yahweh, in this pure spirit state. Other scripture reader, get John 4 and 24. And then we'll back up to 23, but let's just hit 24. Yahweh, in this pure spirit state, he's inscrutable. You can't scrutinize Yahweh. You got to look up the word inscrutable, not do it as homework. He's incomprehensible. You can't comprehend him in this state. He's invisible. John 4:24. Yes.
For Yahweh is spirit.
Yahweh is spirit. Now, can somebody tell me what spirit looks like? You can't see it. You can't touch it. You can't taste it.
Right.
Our senses can't detect spirit.
That's right.
But yet in Romans 1 and 19, it's saying that we may be, some things may be known of Yahweh. Now, how are you going to know something about Yahweh, who's spirit? Continue with John 4 and 24. Yahweh is spirit. Read.
And they that worship him.
They that worship Yahweh.
Must worship him in spirit.
Now
and
listen.
In truth.
It didn't say you can worship him. It said you must worship him. That means you can't do it how you want to do it. That's the problem with the religious world. And that's the problem with people in the IDMR.
Uh-oh.
Got it.
Yeah.
You must worship him in what?
Spirit.
In spirit.
Truth.
Not carnally like we did before coming to a knowledge and understanding. We worship God with our hands. I'm a flight attendant, y'all. And before they get on the airplane, they do this. they kiss the planes. They do all kinds of stuff. You paying tithes. You eat in the Lord's Supper, praise dancing at church. They worshiping God physically. But the Holy Spirit is saying that you must worship Him in spirit and in truth. This is false. This is false. We was worshiping God. We wasn't worshiping Him in truth. We were using Totwell. I was born in this class. Okay? So I never believed in Lord God and Jesus Christ. But yet and still, Yahshua had to make this real to me.
Yes, that's right.
I'm 33. I was in my 20s when He had to sit me down again and say, look up the letter J. Look up the title of Lord. Look up God. He had to make it real to me. I had to go back to the law, which are the first five books of your Bible. I had to read my law. He had to make it real to me, because before it was just what Dr. So-and-so said and Dr. So-and-so said. Yahshua had to make it a living reality in my soul. John 4:24. We got to go back to Romans 1:19. So Yahweh is spirit. In this state, you cannot comprehend Yahweh. His love for us, what did He do? Right within Him own self, He took on shape and form. And that's what the true first speaker, the moderator, stated. That this cloud is showing you how that everything is within Yahweh. Nothing has ever existed outside of Yahweh. That's why you have this black right here. There's nothing outside of Yahweh. So right within the cloud, He took on shape and form right within Himself. And you see it right here. This is Yahweh Elohim, who is truly Yahshua the Messiah. Right within Himself, He took on shape and form. This form can only be seen. Now, I sound like I'm quoting moderation, but if the brethren in these classes could truly understand the moderation, all that confusion, the division, it would be extirpated.
Right
within Himself, He took on shape and form. This form can only be seen in divine visions, understood in revelations. So we're done with John 4:24. Let's go back to Romans 1:19. This is the theme song for this school. Read.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh.
You can know something about your Creator. Read.
Is manifested in them.
Yes.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Yes.
For the invisible things of Him.
Mm-hmm.
From the creation of the world. Are clearly seen.
Invisible things are clearly seen.
How?
Being understood. That means you have some understanding about the Creator.
Being understood by the things that are made.
So in short, we take the natural things that Yahweh Elohim, who is truly Yahshua, that is a mystery to so many people that have been sitting around in these schools. That's a mystery.
That's right.
That you can know something about your Creator. Now, see, I didn't want to go here, but I'm going to go where I am led to go. You can know something about Yahweh, taking the things that He has made. Keep reading.
Being understood by the things that are made.
By the things that are made. You've taken the natural things that Yahweh Elohim made to understand spiritual principles of Himself. Read. Keep reading.
Even His eternal power.
I mean, you can know something about His eternal power? That's the attribute up here. Power. These are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 principal divine attributes of Yahweh, right? So now it's saying His eternal power. Keep reading.
And supernal nature.
His makeup, His Godhead, His supernal nature. So we take something natural to understand something spiritual. But we can know something about His eternal power. That's one of His 9 divine principal attributes. Now we're going to do a Romans 1:19. Taking something natural to understand something spiritual. Mm-hmm. We have 9 principal systems in our body.
That's right.
Why? Because Yahweh has 9 principal attributes. Now, when you start doing research on those systems, the doctors have come up with more. It might be 11 or 12. We have 9 principal systems that function, that make up our tabernacle, pointing to those 9 divine principal attributes of Yahweh. And guess what? We can keep going with the 9. We have 9 principal vessels in this tabernacle pattern. You have the brazen altar of sin sacrifice. You have that brazen laver, that's 2. You have the cup of anointing oil, that's 3. In your most holy place, you have the 7-branch candlestick, 4. Table of shewbread, 5. Altar of incense, 6. That's 3 in your court roundabout, 3 vessels in your holy place. And in your most holy place, you have a 3-in-1 configuration. 9 principal attributes in your tabernacle pattern. Everything testifies to the Creator who made it.
Man.
Keep reading where you are. You have 9 planets in your solar system. Go ahead, Romans.
For the invisible things of Him,
yes,
from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Yes.
Being understood by the things that are made.
Keep reading.
Even His eternal power and supernal nature.
Yes.
So that they are without excuse.
You don't have an excuse. We don't have an excuse down here now. Keep reading.
Because that when they knew Yahweh, they glorified Him not as Elohim.
When they knew Yahweh, they glorified Him not as Elohim. Read.
Neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened.
And see, that's, we don't want that testimony. We don't want to become vain in our imaginations, in the hallucinations. And we talked about it tonight. You know, you have drugs, right? Natural drugs that causes hallucinations. And people will take these drugs to get high. But listen, y'all, this knowledge that Yahshua is giving us, it is a high that cannot even be compared. Mm-hmm. And trust me, I know what I'm talking about.
That's right.
Because me and Mary Jane, we had a relationship for a while. I'm just being completely honest. But this knowledge and understanding, that physical from the earth, mm-hmm. We don't want nothing from the earth. We want a spiritual revelation from Yahshua the Messiah. And He's doing that to His sons. He's opening up our understanding.
That's right.
So now let's go ahead and get Luke 24 and 25. This, where they're reading, this was after Yahshua went through this death, burial, and resurrection.
Luke 24 and 25.
So now, hold on 1 second, because He went through this death, burial, resurrection. Where is it? Is it Mark?
Matthew
16. Let's get Matthew 16 and 12. I'm just going to set some stuff up, and I'm going to have my seat, because there's preliminary things in this school that we're standing in. We're standing in the gospel. We're standing in the scriptures. And I'm going to hit those things, because we can have an understanding, and that's something that was in our scripture lesson tonight.
Matthew 16 and 20.
Yes.
It's 16:21.
From that time forth began Yahshua to show unto His disciples how that He must go into Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed,
mm-hmm.
and be raised again the third day.
So now you have Yahshua preaching His own death, burial, and resurrection. So now, these disciples walked around with Him for some 3.5 years. They didn't fully understand what He was talking about. They didn't get it. So now He's gone through this terrible death, burial, this death, the dying, the death of an outcast dog. He was buried in Joseph's new tomb. The third day, he resurrected. So now it's the third day, and you have these two disciples on the way to Emmaus, and they're sad in their heart because they just witnessed something so just, you know, when you think about this death and how the entire creation reacted to Yahshua's death. See, there were people before Yahshua who proclaimed to be messiahs, and there were people before Yahshua who were crucified. But when Yahshua died on this cross, the whole creation reacted to his death on that cross. So now, if you in your house, right, on this day that he died, this death, you in your house, you're going to feel the earth, the physical earth shaking. You're going to see the darkness. Yeah, you're a Jew. You don't know nothing about what's going on with no Yahshua, nothing. But it's 12 o'clock, and it's dark outside.
Yeah.
You know something's up.
Yeah.
The earth testified. The earth reacted to this death.
That's right.
It's the third day now. They're sad in their hearts. Because now Yahshua said he was going to resurrect. They don't see him. Where is he? He said he was going to come and resurrect. They sat in their hearts. So what does Yahshua do? He appears unto them. And it says, I believe in the 13th or 15th verse, that their eyes were holding.
That's right.
They didn't recognize him. So now drop to 25. And what does Yahshua say to these men?
Read Luke 24:25.
Yes.
Then he said unto them, All fools!
That means you're slow of understanding.
And slow of heart.
Read.
To believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Okay, so now we have to stop there. Because in this school, we learn that the scriptures, just really quick. Read where you at. To believe all that what?
The prophets have spoken.
Right.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things?
Shouldn't I have suffered these things? Remember, we read where Yahshua was telling them. He foretold. See, this is the beautiful thing about Yahweh Elohim Yahshua. He's a just El.
There you go.
See, now, when the children of Israel, when they got out here in the land of when they were delivered, and they were out here in the wilderness, before they were going to cross over, you read it in Deuteronomy, those blessings and those curses. Yahweh told them, if you're obedient, this is the short version, I will bless you. I will multiply you. I will be good to you. Your crops are going to be great. But if you're disobedient, now this is the short version now, I'm going to curse you. You know, so he lets you know. He lets you know. He's letting us know, right? We don't have no excuse. We can come up with a million, thousand, trillion excuses. We don't have an excuse because Yahshua is giving us a way to know him. Oh, fools, read it.
Oh, fools and slow of heart, believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Mm-hmm.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
So now what our Savior did is he took them boys back. So now he's telling them, oh fools and slow of heart. See, the Jews, they were given, all right, the scriptures, the first five books of your Bible, the accredited writer is Moses. That is the law. The next 34 books of your Bible, that's the prophets. The prophets were testifying and witnessing. So it's the testimony of the prophets. the first 5 books of your Bible, the next 34 books of your Bible equals 39 books, which is a volume. This is what the Jews had. When Yahshua was walking around in the flesh, they didn't have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They had the scriptures. So now Yahshua is saying, oh, fools and slow of heart, to believe all
that the prophets have spoken.
Y'all had the scriptures.
Read, ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things?
Shouldn't I have suffered these things? Y'all have the scriptures.
And to enter into his glory.
Read.
And beginning at Moses.
So what Yahshua did, and listen, we're still doing it down here. This day, we're not changing anything. If it worked for these boys back here, the preaching of the gospel on the day of Pentecost, they were filled with the Holy Spirit.
Oh, bring it home.
That's in our age, in dispensation. Why is it different now? Now that we at the end, it's not good anymore. It's antiquated. If it worked for them, the Jews, 7 years later for the Gentiles, they weren't laying no hands on these men down here. They was preaching the gospel. If it worked for them, if it don't work for us, keep reading. So by going, by Yahshua, the Holy Spirit, he's still doing it tonight.
And beginning at Moses,
he took them back to the law.
Read. And all the prophets.
And all the prophets.
And he expounded unto them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself.
He expounded. He went into great detail. Keep reading.
Let me drop down to 44.
I want you to know. Keep reading.
And they drew nigh unto the village, mm-hmm. whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further.
I think it might be, well, keep reading, because it might be 29 or 30. Keep reading.
But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening.
Uh-huh.
The day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them.
Yes.
And it came to pass, as he sat
yes.
at the table with them,
yes.
he took bread
yes.
and blessed it
yes.
and brake
mm-hmm.
and gave to them.
Mm-hmm.
And immediately their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished
you know
out
what?
Of their sight.
They knew him because he did that. He did that back here. Keep reading.
And they said one to another,
yes.
did not our heart burn?
Their hearts burned
within us.
Yes.
While he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures.
He opened them scriptures. He went into great details of the things concerning himself.
And they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem, found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them, saying, Yahshua is risen indeed and hath appeared to Simon. And they told what things were done in the way.
So
and
go now, on, just, I'm
44.
Sorry. Yes.
And he said unto them,
yes.
these are the words which I spake unto you
yes.
while I was yet with you.
Yes.
That all things.
He said all. He didn't say some things.
All
he said
things.
All things.
Must be fulfilled.
That must word.
Must be fulfilled.
Yes, keep reading.
Which were written in the law of
yes.
Moses.
Yes.
And in the prophets.
And in the prophets.
And in the Psalms.
Yes.
Concerning me.
Concerning your dean.
Concerning me.
Concerning the Pope.
Concerning me.
Because I've seen people go to the law and pick out some stuff to correlate with their dean. I have seen it. It's concerning Yahshua, the
That's
Messiah.
Right.
Period.
That's right.
Then open he their understanding.
And guess what, ladies and gentlemen? By him, by Yahshua going to the law and the prophets, their understanding was opened.
Mm-hmm. That they might understand the scripture.
And it says might. Because guess what? It wasn't until the day of Pentecost mm-hmm. that they fully understood
right.
what was going on. So now these scriptures, there's something important about them scriptures now. So now you got to go to John 5. What is Yahshua saying to the scribes and Pharisees? See, these scribes and Pharisees that were Jews, right? They had the scriptures. And they were just so high-minded. They just thought they were somebody because they had these scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
What did Yahshua say to the scribes and to the Pharisees?
John 5:39.
Yes.
Search the
scriptures. Yahshua said, skim through the scriptures.
Search.
He says, search the scriptures. Isn't this a school of what?
Research.
The research has been done.
We research in the research.
That's right.
Right.
The work has been done. Yahshua says, search the scriptures.
For in them you think you have eternal life.
Listen, your pastor had y'all doing all kinds of stuff. He'll open up the Bible where he felt led.
Mm-mm.
Keep reading.
Search the scriptures. Read.
For in them you think you have eternal life.
Yes.
That they are they which testify of me.
Yes. They're testifying of Yahshua.
That's right.
Let's go ahead and get, because I'm running out of time. Let's get a parable. Let's get Luke. What did he say to, I feel like I'm jumping. 16. But let's get Luke 16. Because this is a parable that Yahshua was giving about the rich man and the poor man. And in the rich man's life, he wasn't good to people.
Yeah. 16 and what?
3.
16,
and this is a parable now.
16 and 19.
16 and 19.
Yes.
There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen,
mm-hmm.
and fared sumptuously every day.
Yes.
And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus which was laid at his gate full of sores, and that desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich
man's
feet.
Listen, it says that the poor man was just desiring to be fed with the crumbs.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, I just want crumbs.
Right.
Because these little crumbs, these little nuggets in this school will blow your mind.
That's right.
I love this chart. Because through the preaching of the gospel, something is happening to us. Something is happening. We came in here dead on arrival. But through the preaching of the gospel, Yahshua is making a new creature.
Right.
You got to keep your finger in the book. You got to stick with the law and the prophets. Read. The man just wanted crumbs. Read.
Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores.
Yes.
And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom.
Yes.
The rich man also died and was buried. And in Sheol he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom.
So now, when it's talking about Abraham, Abraham is just a type of the Father.
That's right.
He's just a type. So now the rich man sees Lazarus, the poor man that he couldn't care 2 cents about, just walk past. He sees Lazarus. Lazarus is in the bosom. Read.
And he cried and said, Father Abraham,
mm-hmm.
have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his
finger. So now Lazarus is in the bosom. He's in heaven. And he's being tormented. Read.
The tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented.
So he wants him to come down. He's in a state of peace, joy, and happiness. He ain't thinking about nothing. But now you're in hell. You're tormented. Read.
In this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime
yes.
receiveth thy good things.
Yes.
And likewise Lazarus, evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented.
Yes.
And beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf
there
fixed.
There is a great. And there's a great gulf fixed. Keep reading.
So that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us
mm-hmm.
that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto
so
them.
So now he's in a state of peace, joy, happiness, and he wants him, just send him to my brethren. Read.
Lest they also come into this place
so
of
torment. So they won't come to this place of torment. Just send them, please. Read.
Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them.
Listen. Hold on. 1 second. This is a parable, but it has so much, it has a beautiful meaning.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying they have the scriptures.
Right.
They have Moses and the prophets. Read.
And he said, nay, Father Abraham.
No. Read.
But if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto them, if they hear not Moses and the prophets,
wow.
neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead.
That's amazing. He didn't want to even accept that. Okay, really quick, let's get 1 Corinthians 15 and 1.
First Corinthians 15 and 1.
Yes.
Moreover, brethren,
yes.
I declare unto you the glad tidings which I preached unto you.
Stop really quick, and if the other scripture reader can get Romans 16. Go ahead. Keep reading.
Which I preached unto you, which also you have received.
So now this is the Apostle Paul. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. And this is to Corinth. This was a school in Corinth. And Paul is declaring unto them the gospel. Now, before Yahshua called us into this school, I was taught in college. It's a religion college course. And they taught us in school that there were four gospels.
Right.
The gospel of Matthew, the gospel according to Mark, the gospel according to Luke, the gospel according to John. But Paul is declaring the gospel. And that's not plural. That's singular.
Right.
He's declaring unto you the gospel. Read.
Wherein you stand.
Which I preach. Go ahead and read it again. I'm declaring unto you the gospel.
Moreover, brethren, mm-hmm. I declare unto you the glad tidings which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you.
So you can be saved in the gospel, if you keep it in memory. Read.
Unless you have believed in vain.
And we don't want to make it vain now. Vain, fruitless, worthless. Of no value, especially if you can be saved in the gospel. Read.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Yes.
How that Yahshua died for our sins.
How he died.
According to the scriptures.
According to the scriptures. How Yahshua died according to the law.
That's right.
And the prophets. Read.
And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures.
According to the law and the prophets.
And that he was seen by Kepha, and then by the 11.
That's good. So now, when we examine the scriptures, and we're examining that death, that burial, and that resurrection, we go to our pattern. Because when Yahweh sent Moses to deliver the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, they were delivered by a death, pointing to Yahshua, death of the Lamb. They were buried in the Red Sea and in the cloud. 1 Corinthians 10 and 1. Y'all wouldn't believe that we had some individual get a...
1 Corinthians 10 and 1. Moreover, brethren.
No. 1 Corinthians. Oh, I'm sorry. You're right.
Moreover, brethren.
Yes.
I would not that you should be ignorant.
Now, Paul is saying, I don't want you to be ignorant about this, ladies and gentlemen.
How that all our fathers were under the cloud.
They were under the cloud.
And all passed through the sea.
They passed through the sea.
And were all baptized unto Moses.
They were baptized unto Moses.
In the cloud.
In the cloud.
And in the sea.
And in the sea.
And did all eat the same spiritual meat.
Yes.
And did all drink the same spiritual drink.
Yes.
For they drank of that spiritual rock that led them.
Yes.
And that rock was Messiah.
And that rock was the Messiah. The Messiah was back here with them, leading them. Y'all wouldn't believe that we had somebody say, well, the Messiah wasn't back here. Moses was the type of the Messiah. Now, you just read. You got to keep your finger in the book and stick with what Yahshua has delivered to us. Don't. Them concepts and opinions, we are supposed to be extirpating that. That's aim number 5. To extirpate current superstition, current ignorance, past, present, or future ignorance.
Yeah.
Keep your finger in the book, to the law, and to the prophets. So now there was a death pointing to Yahshua. They were buried in the Red Sea. They didn't get wet. This type of a burial was pointing to Yahshua being buried. They resurrected into the wilderness. Now guess what? This was a 2-day journey to the Red Sea, a 1-day journey through the Red Sea. That's a principle of what? 3. Yahshua died, buried, and he resurrected the 3rd day. So now you have that with your pattern. So now when Moses, when they were led out into the wilderness, Yahweh called Moses the top of Mount Sinai. He called, I'm cutting it up, but it was 74 that saw Yahweh Elohim. And so, just really quick, because now I have 4 minutes, let's get volume. Oh, okay, so guess what? That means I'm I thought he accidentally kicked me. I'll play with my motion. Okay, so you know you can get up here and Yahshua will catch you up. Alright, so listen. I am so happy to be here. I came to eat. Y'all wanted me to cook. Y'all was the teacher in this school. And we're just so grateful for the nuggets and the crumbs that he's given us. All honor, all glory, all praise goes to Yahweh, our Elohim, through his son, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Stand still.
Okay, thank you for that. Let me get my paper here. I got a poor memory. Our next speaker will be Seth Williams.
Whoa. Go, Seth.
Seth, huh?
Good evening.
Good evening.
And I truly appreciate the comments of the first speaker. And we're going to just try to pick up where she left off. But first, you know, like she said, it's a pleasure to be able to join the brethren and eventually sup with them. But this is a trip that we've been talking about coming on for probably like 3-4 years, and I'm thankful through the Father, for the Father allowing us to make this trip. She was talking about, she finished off with the gospel, and she had Romans 1:16 called, but she didn't have it read. But the Apostle Paul in Romans 1:16, he's saying he's not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of Yahweh. That's good. Let's have it read.
Okay, Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
And when we come down here, that's all we need to be teaching. You know, Romans, 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, said that you can be saved in the gospel if you keep it in memory. So when we come down here, it's for soul salvation. It's not for anything else other than soul salvation. So how do you obtain, you know, how is your soul going to be saved? It's through the preaching of the gospel. It's through the death, the burial, the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. So when we come down to these schools, that's the only thing that really need to be talked about.
That's right.
I mean, it's that cut and dry. So the Apostle Paul in Romans said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Read.
Of the Messiah, for it is the power.
See, he's not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
Right.
It is the power.
For it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation.
It's the power of Yahweh. And she talked about that. Those divine attributes. One of the attributes is power. It is the gospel is the power of Yahweh. Read.
Unto salvation.
Unto salvation.
To everyone that believeth.
To everyone that believeth. Now you can't believe in something that you know nothing about. It's impossible. So when you come down here, or if you go to church, they need to be teaching you about the gospel. Mm-hmm. Not the gospels, because there is no gospels. Mm-hmm. You know, if you really do some research, who was it? Luke and Mark, they didn't even walk around with the Messiah. So you really need to know what the gospel is. It's the death, the burial, the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. And it takes some research to learn these things. It has to be taught. And you have to take what you're hearing, and you have to go home, and you have to look it up. See if it's true. See if we lied to you. Because we, you know, I didn't come all the way to California to come get on YouTube and lie to somebody. No. That's not what this is about. It's about soul salvation.
Right.
Okay? But the gospel is the power of Yahweh to them that believe. For salvation to them that believe. Mm-hmm. Now, the mission of the Messiah. Matthew 5:17, the Messiah himself says that he came in to fulfill the law and the prophets. So we need to know what the law and the prophets are. Now, if you're at home, if you're watching on TV, I'm going to call scriptures. You got to write them down because I can't have everything read because I want to make sure I won't go past that bill. But you have Isaiah 8:20. You know what? Let's have this read, but get it at 18. Isaiah 18:18.
Behold, am I right? Yeah. I and the children whom Yahweh hath given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel.
See, slow that down. Read it again, but slow it down.
Okay. Isaiah.
Now this is
8:18.
This is Isaiah.
Mm-hmm. Behold, I and the children whom Yahweh hath given me.
I and the children whom Yahweh hath given me.
Are for signs.
Are for signs.
And for wonders.
And for wonders.
In Israel.
Uh-huh.
From the Yahweh of hosts, which mm-hmm. dwelleth in Mount Zion.
So when we're talking about these scriptures, they're for signs and wonders for the children of Israel. Because the law and the prophets were only given to the children of Israel. Now I'm making a distinction. Because when we come down here and we talk about this law, this was not given to a Gentile.
Right.
You pick that up in Exodus, don't get it. You pick that up in Exodus, the 19th chapter, where you had the children of Israel gathered here at the base of Mount Sinai. And Yahweh tells Moses to have the children of Israel wash up and clean up, because in 3 days he's going to speak that law down. There were no Gentiles out here. They weren't out here. Okay? So that law wasn't given to them. Isaiah is confirming it. This was given for signs and wonders to who? The children of Israel. They had the law and the prophets. That's why Yahshua in Luke 24:25 called them old fools and slow of heart. Because they were the ones that had the law and the prophets. The Gentiles didn't have it. They didn't know nothing about the law and the prophets. And we'll eventually get to that. So then, if anybody is going to teach anybody anything, they have to go to the law and the prophets, because it's talking about the Messiah. And that's Hebrews 10:7, where the Apostle Paul is confirming that, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book, where Yahshua is saying, I come in the volume of the book.
Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book.
See, these 39 books, the first 5 books of your Bible, the next 34 books of the Bible equals 39 books. That's one volume. Yahshua is saying, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me. It's not written of anybody else. So when your Bible just falls to, you know, whatever, it's not talking about you.
That's right.
It's talking about Yahshua.
Right.
We're going back to Luke. Because when they didn't have any understanding and they were sad in their heart, he went to the law and the prophets to give them some understanding. So that's why we examine the law and the prophets, because it's an example. She had 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. Let's get that. 1 Corinthians 10:6. We're talking about the law and the prophets. These children of Israel, they're an example.
1 Corinthians 10:6.
Mm-hmm.
Now these things were our examples.
See, these things, them going through the divided waters of the Red Sea, being buried in that cloud, not getting wet, but being delivered in the trials and tribulations that they went through back here, following that phenomenal cloud. All that was an example.
To the intent we should not lust after evil things.
See, and it's an example for correction and stuff like that. So we have to go and examine these things. It's not talking about us. It's talking about Yahshua the Messiah. How he came in to fulfill these things. Why? Because there was a promise given. That's in Genesis. Genesis, what is that? 15. Where Yahweh tells Abraham that I'm going to bless your seed. And Yahshua is that blessing that he's talking about. Let me slow down because I don't want to be all over the place. We're talking about the mission of Yahshua the Messiah. Why he had to die the death of an outcast dog. This is what I'm talking about. So if you keep that in mind, it might look like I'm jumping places, but we're talking about the mission of the Messiah. He came in to move this out of the way.
That's right.
For the Jews. And then we get grafted in by promise, by faith.
That's right.
Not by works. By faith. Not by works. By faith. So, Yahshua, Matthew 5:17 says, think not that I am come to destroy the law and the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. See, he was coming in to move those things out of the way, so we're not bound to, so the Jews weren't bound to those things anymore. I'm not going to say we, I'm not a physical, natural Jew. So the Jews weren't bound to that anymore. So he had to come in and physically perform these things. And these things weren't set up because she, and I'm going this way because she said that the religious world teaches us that Jesus came in to set up a Christian example for us to follow or a way of life. So in Matthew, the 3rd chapter, when you see Yahshua getting baptized by John, the religious world tells you that you need to be baptized.
Right.
Not so. Let's take the words of the Messiah. Even in this chapter and the verse, let's get that. We're going to talk about Yahshua fulfilling some of this stuff. Get Matthew 3:1.
Matthew 3:1.
Mm-hmm.
In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea.
See, Yahshua, now John the Baptist, he's teaching in the wilderness of Judea. Keep going.
And saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Mm-hmm.
For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying,
mm-hmm.
The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of Yahweh and make his path straight.
Mm-hmm. Drop down to 5.
5. Mm-hmm. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins.
Now note. Now, Yahshua and John didn't have some side meeting and say, John, I need you to go out there and start baptizing people because you're going to be setting up a Christian example. That's not what happened.
Right.
See, John, Yahshua, had been baptized. So he wasn't setting anything up. The Jews were coming to John already being baptized. So Jesus, truly Yahshua, this is happening before he comes to him to be baptized. So he's not setting anything up. It's already taking place. So now it says all of Judea, all the Jews were coming to John to be baptized. Not all of them, but the ones that believed, they were coming to John to be baptized.
Confessing their sins.
Confessing their sins.
But when you saw many
of the Pharisees. It didn't say any Gentiles were there. It didn't say any Romans were there. No Arabs were there. No, it was only the Jews. The Jews and the Jews only. No Gentile was at this party. Like, there was no Gentile at this party. There were no Gentiles at this party. All the Jews of Judea came to John to be baptized. Then cometh Yahshua, 11th verse.
11th verse. I indeed baptize you with water.
See, now John's saying, I indeed baptize you with water. Yep, you right.
I'm sorry. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear.
Mm-hmm.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire.
See, now he's saying that, look, I'm baptizing you with water, but the one that's coming after me is going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire.
13 verse.
So now when people are getting baptized in these baptismal pools, they're not getting baptized with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Can your preacher tell you how that's done?
Mm-hmm.
No. They baptize you with water. The one that's coming after John, he gonna baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So you just getting wet. That's it. When those Gentiles back here getting baptized in the first place, and if you down here getting baptized now, it's of no effect. Why? Because this was being fulfilled. And how are we gonna prove that? Yahshua's gonna come in and do it. Drop down to 13.
13. Then cometh Yahshua unto Galilee, to Jordan, unto John,
mm-hmm.
to be baptized of him.
See, now he's coming to be baptized. John been baptized already. Now he's coming to be baptized. Keep going.
But John forbade him, saying, Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan to John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?
See, John, he wasn't perfect. He sinned himself. So when Yahshua comes to John to be baptized, John is asking, he asks everybody else, have you sinned? They say yes. He say repent. He baptized them. Go sin no more. Yahshua come to John. Yahshua, have you sinned? No. Well, hey, I have need to be baptized of you because I've sinned. Why are you coming to me? What did Yahshua say to him?
And Yahshua answered and said unto him, suffer it to be so now.
Just do it, John.
For thus it becometh us to fulfill
for
all
thus righteousness. It becometh us to institute water baptism.
No.
That's not what it says.
Fulfill.
It says, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. So now, water baptism is fulfilled. It's done away with. And this is not going to do nothing for you. Why? Because he's moving this out of the way. Moving that out of the way. Now, it's like when you get up here, you just... Lord's Supper. And I definitely want to hit this. Give me Exodus 12. See, she had 1 Corinthians already read, how the children of Israel, they were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Yahshua had to come in to fulfill that. So then you have the children of Israel, and this is where, this is the Passover that's going to be instituted. Okay? So now this Passover, and what I really want, because I'm gonna get through the menu, but drop down to 12, and I think it's like 38. Because it talks about, wasn't nobody else at this party. I want to emphasize that. Nobody else is at this party. This law that Yahshua came in to fulfill was for the Jews and the Jews only. Then we're going to get to how we come into the fold.
Mm-hmm.
So now, Exodus 12 and 1, Yahweh sets up time with the children of Israel. Tells them that January is not the first of the year. It's April. That's 12 and 1. Write it down. Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It should be the first month of the year to you. Then you jump over to the 13th chapter, the 4th verse. It's going to say that this month came ye out in the month of Abib,
right.
Meaning April is the first of the year. So then Yahweh is going to give them a Passover. They have to take out a lamb on the 10th of April. They have to examine that lamb for 4 days. On that fourth day, they're going to take that lamb out. They're going to kill that lamb. They're going to pierce that lamb in the side, drain the blood. They're going to take that blood. They're going to strike it on the lintel, the two side posts, and they're dipping that blood from the basin, making 4 points on the door. Yahweh is going to instruct them that this blood has to be on the inside of that door because the death angel is going to pass over. And every man that doesn't have that blood on the inside of their door, the death angel is going to kill the firstborn of both man and beast. Now, the children of Israel knew this. The Egyptians, they weren't invited to the party. They had no idea what was going on. So then we got the menu. It was roasted lamb to be eaten, bitter herbs, and unleavened bread. I'm in Exodus, the 12th chapter. I don't have a lot of time because I want to get to where we're going. But he set up that menu, and it was with the children of Israel and the children of Israel only. So then drop down to 12 and 38 because he's given specific instructions how this is for them and them only. It has nothing to do with us.
Right.
12 and 38.
Mm-hmm.
And the mixed multitude went up also with them.
Or is it 44?
44. But every man's servant that is bought for money,
mm-hmm.
when thou hast circumcised him, then shall he eat thereof. A foreigner and an hired servant shall not eat thereof.
See, he's talking about this Passover. A foreigner, anybody that wasn't a Jew, and a hired servant, anybody who, if they weren't circumcised, see, once you were circumcised, you were not grafted in with them. But if you were a foreigner and you weren't riding with them, you're not to eat of this.
That's right.
You weren't invited to the party.
Right.
We're not invited to the party. Now, that's law. I mean, Ezra 6:19, you don't have to get it. Ezekiel 45:21, you don't have to get it. Numbers, the 9th chapter, it'll tell you that if you couldn't eat it on April the 14th, you can eat it on May the 14th. And those are the only two dates that you can eat of the Passover.
That's right.
You can pick that up in, 2 Chronicles, the 30th chapter, 2 Chronicles, the 35th chapter. Write it down. Go check it out for yourself. There was only 2 days you can eat the Passover, and it was supposed to be eaten on April the 14th, April the 14th only, by way of a dead body, or you're on a far-off journey. You can eat it on May the 14th, and that was it. So, gave you law, gave you prophecy, you looked that up. But now you got Yahshua coming in to fulfill it in Matthew, the 26th chapter. Let's get Matthew 26 and 1.
Matthew 26 and 1.
Because the religious world say Jesus came in to set up a Christian example for us to follow.
And it came to pass, when Yahshua had finished all these things, he said unto his disciples, ye know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover.
Now, he wouldn't be able to say, ye know that in 2 days is the feast of the Passover. He was setting it up. We've already explained how it was set up 1,500 years ago with the children of Israel back in Egypt. Ye know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is to be crucified. Drop down, 17.
Now, the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Yahshua, saying unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover?
See, and I didn't have it read, but that Passover was eaten back here in their house. So that's why the disciples had to ask Yahshua, where are we going to eat the Passover? Because the custom is, you got to eat it in your house, not the church of your choice. And not on the first Sunday, it was on a specific day, okay? So it didn't change because the Jews wanted it to change. No, it was a specific day, at a specific time, at a specific place, in your house. Where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? Yahshua says, go into the city to such a man, and tell him the master said, my time is at hand, I will eat the Passover at thy house with thy disciples.
Right.
Drop down. And then it says, 19th verse, and when the evening was come. See, they ate it in the evening back here in the land of Egypt.
20th verse. Now when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12.
Mm-hmm.
And as they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you, one of you shall betray me. 26
verse.
26 and 26. Mm-hmm. And as they were eating.
See, now as they were eating.
Yahshua took bread.
So, now, when you examine this, if you knew what the story, if you knew how to get the story right in the beginning, you know that they're eating two things. They're two things to eat, one thing to drink.
Mm-hmm.
Two things to eat, one thing to drink. It didn't say crackers, grape juice, wafer, wine back here. So when we get down here, they're not eating cracker, grape juice, wafer, wine. No, they're eating roasted lamb. So now, as they were eating the roasted lamb, Yahshua took the bread
and blessed it.
He blessed
and
it.
Broke it.
And he broke it.
And gave it to
and
his disciples.
And he gave it to his disciples.
And said, take.
He said, take.
Eat.
This. That.
This.
That.
This.
That.
This.
This is my body. See, he didn't say, that is my body. He said, this is my body. Because it said that he gave the bread to them after he broke it. So he can't say that the bread is his body because he no longer has possession of it. Okay? This is my body. Then he took the cup.
And gave thanks.
He gave thanks.
Gave it to them.
He gave it to them saying,
drink ye all of it.
Save some for the Roman Catholics. Save some for the Baptists. Save some for the Methodists. The Luke, save some for them. No, he said, drink ye all of it.
For this is
for
my,
that.
For this.
For that.
This.
For that in the cup.
This is
that in the cup.
This is my blood.
No, he said, this is my blood.
Of the New Testament.
Of the New Testament.
Which is shed for me,
mm-hmm.
for the remission of sin.
Now this, they try to say this is the Last Supper, where you eat it every Sunday. of the month. So when is it going to be the Last Supper?
But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.
See, now, when he does it new, it's not going to be like the old. He came in to fulfill that, move it out of the way. And it is, I mean, there's so many things we can get into. The foot washings. I mean, we don't have enough time to get into all the things that Yahshua fulfilled in one class. But now, we talked about that understanding that he gave them by going to the law and the prophets. And she said that they weren't going to fully understand what was going on until the day of Pentecost. So then we need to examine what happened on the day of Pentecost. On the day of Pentecost. Now they were told to wait in Jerusalem until they received power on high. And then, Acts the second chapter, they received of that Holy Spirit, and the Jews went out preaching the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. See, and it was the Jews and the Jews only that were here in the upper room at this time. And she said it, that the Gentiles, 7 years later, that's when we received of the promise. But then when they went down there, they weren't teaching them, all right, well, you got to, you know, do this, and you got to keep the law of Moses, and you got to be baptized, and you got to eat the Lord's Supper. And they didn't teach them that because they understood, the ones that truly understood, they understood that that was out. So then when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the Gentiles, it was just the preaching of the gospel. And I'll give you the scripture, that's Acts the second chapter, that the Jews received of the Holy Spirit, and Acts the 10th chapter, the Gentiles received of the Holy Spirit. So let's get Acts the 10th chapter, because this is where we come into the fold. And you have all these different organizations out there. They might use the true name of Yahweh and Yahshua, but they're still trying to do some type of carnal ordinances. The Hebrew Israelites, I have friends, they're part of the, you know, of that. They use a true name, but they want to stick you back under here. But they don't understand the mission of Yahshua the Messiah. He said himself he came in to fulfill this. So if he's fulfilling it, and you look up the definition of fulfill, it's to complete, to finish, to bring to an end, to convert into reality.
That's right.
Now the conversion into the converting into reality, that means that you're not physically circumcised anymore. You're spiritually circumcised. How are you spiritually circumcised? That carnality, that fleshly mind is cut away.
Right. Very good.
Baptism. How are you how are you spiritually baptized? In the name. You're preached, the gospel is preached to you. That's how you're washed and cleansed.
Right.
And I didn't even touch baptism. But you're washed and cleansed, not physically, spiritually. Why? Because in the brain, what is it? The fluid in the brain. That's the cleanest water on the face of the earth. The spinal fluid. That's the cleanest water on the face of the earth. We all have it. So why you have Jeffrey Dahmers and you know, all these people killing up people and mass murder? They got the same clean water you got in your. But what's the difference? See, it's not a physical water baptism. It's a spiritual water baptism. Eating the Passover. See, we supping. We came here to sup. I'm glad I'm getting out of the way. Because we came here to sup. We're not physically eating. And she talked about laying on hands. And I was looking at this. I'm a sidetrack because I didn't understand what laying on hands was. Mm-hmm. You know, it talked about how back with the apostles, how they laid hands on people. And I was like, what is laying on hands? Exodus 24:9, where it says that then went up Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders, and they saw the element of Israel, and there was under his feet as a paved work of a sapphire stone, and the body of heaven, as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness, and upon the children of Israel he laid not his hands. What does that mean? He didn't give them the understanding.
That's right.
Of what they were seeing. So when the apostles were laying hands on people, they weren't physically laying hands on people. They were getting the understanding of this thing.
Right.
They were getting that understanding. So now, I heard the bell. 5 minutes. 5 minutes. You have Peter going down to Cornelius' house. And the 10th chapter of Exodus, you don't have to get it because I don't have enough time. But in the 10th chapter of Acts, you have Peter going down to Cornelius' house and he preaches the gospel. He gives them the name. He talks about the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, and they receive the Holy Spirit. In Acts 10:44, say the Holy Spirit just fell on them. And then the Jews that went with them, see, and they had the Holy Spirit and they didn't understand everything. Because when the angel came to Peter and he said, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Peter had the Holy Spirit, but he didn't understand that it was time for him to go to the Gentiles. Remember, he was told, don't mingle with them people. His people were told, look, don't mingle with the Gentiles. So when he goes here, he didn't understand what was going on. But Yahweh had to tell him, look, Peter, when the men come, don't you hesitate to go. You just go. See, he didn't understand everything just because he received the Holy Spirit right here. He still had some things to learn. Mm-hmm. So then when he went down here, he preached the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah to them, and the Holy Spirit fell on them. And then the ones that went with him who had the Holy Spirit, they didn't understand what happened. They were astonished. This is how you know the Holy Spirit. Look, it's a growing in grace process. Even when you do have, you're still growing in grace. Because they were like, how did the Holy Spirit fall on them like it did on us? Mm-hmm. See, they had the Holy Spirit and still didn't understand. Mm-hmm. Didn't understand. So then when they went back to Jerusalem, and the ones that had the Holy Spirit was trying to chastise Peter for going down there in the first place, they didn't understand. Peter had to say, look, no, in the 11th chapter, look, I went down there because the angel told Cornelius to send for somebody to tell you how you can be saved. So then when Peter get down here to preach to them, he didn't preach, you need to keep the law of Moses, you need to do this, you need to do that. He didn't preach that.
Right.
Okay? He preached the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, and their souls were saved. So then what we have now, Acts the 15th chapter. Now I want to get this read. And this is for out there, that's for in here. This is for the world, this is for the ones at IDMR.
Acts 15:1.
You keep it the way it's given. No, not 15:1.
7, disputing.
Yeah. See, there was a controversy. There was a you know what? No, I don't want that. Get me Acts 17:1. Acts 17:1. That's what I want.
Acts 17:1. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis, mm-hmm, so, and Apollonia.
Now it's talking about the Apostle Paul. Now they had to escape from somewhere, and they passed through Pamphylia, and yeah, keep going.
They came to Thessalonica, mm-hmm, where was a synagogue of the Jews.
Uh-huh.
And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures.
And that's what our manner need to be. 3 Sabbath days, they doing nothing but look in the Scriptures. Death, burial, resurrection, love, water, spirit, 40, tabernacle pattern. I mean, that's what they're doing. As his manner was, that need to be your manner. If you claim that you know something about Yahshua, if you claim you have the truth, then your manner need to be the same as theirs. Law, prophecy, fulfillment, death, burial, resurrection, blood, water, spirit, 40, to the law, to the testimony. Shouldn't change. Keep going.
Opening and alleging that the Messiah must needs have suffered, mm-hmm, and risen again from the dead, and that this Yahshua, which I preach unto you, is the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them believe, mm-hmm, and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few.
Mm-hmm.
But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy,
mm-hmm,
and took unto them certain lewd fellows, mm-hmm, of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar.
See, they was assaulted. In the cliques. They was in the cliques. That's
and assaulted, alone. And assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren to the rulers of the city,
mm-hmm,
crying, "These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also."
Drop down to what? 10. 10. Drop 10. Down to 10, yeah.
10. So that's 17 and 10, Acts. And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas
by night
to Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica.
See, now they're in Berea. Now it talks about these being more noble than those in Thessalonica. Read.
In that they received the word with all readiness of mind.
They ready to sup.
The scriptures
they
daily.
Ready to sup. And they say they search the scriptures daily.
Right.
Whether those things are so. Therefore many of them believed. Also of honorable women which were Greeks and of the men not a few.
And that's good. Look. If anybody claim to have any knowledge about their creator, right. You search the scriptures on them. If they did it back then to the apostles that we read about, then who are you? Ask your questions. And if I'm saying something, question me about it. I'm going to question you about it. Why? Because I want to be more noble. And I want the truth. I want to search those things. I want to just believe it because you said it.
Right.
And don't believe it just because I said it.
Right.
With those few words, I hope somebody got something out of it. I'm so happy to be here. We've had a marvelous time already, and it's only day one. So, I can't wait for the rest of the days to come. Hallelujah, peace, and love. In Yahshua.
Thank you. Enjoyed that. Our next speaker will be John Williams from the Orlando Pratt School. Save the best for the last. There you go. At least we got the same color beard.
See, I'm not going to comment on that last expression because of the fact that I'm just grateful to be here in Ontario, and I thank the Father for the Unity in Yah study group that planned this trip and invited my wife and I to be a part of such a beautiful experience, and we're just so grateful to be here. And just keeping the trend of thought flowing that the previous speakers were expressing. When we think about the mission of Yahshua the Messiah, and like the previous speaker was stating, because we are asked to say Gentiles after the flesh, heathens, right, of the nations, because we're not physical, literal Israelites, or Hebrews. So because Yahweh has blessed humanity through this great panoramic divine vision, and we're able to reference the vision, and as you see it illustrated all around the charts on this, I mean, we're just compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses. I mean, this is just too beautiful. And it all is a witness of the eternal creator.
That's right.
It's not to serve, honor, glorify men,
right,
or personalities. Is to glorify our Creator, who is inscrutable, invisible, incomprehensible, indiscernible, and in that state of ontological perfection, and these terms we're learning through this gospel, this is His mission. And you know, we have the tools that Yahweh has given us, and I really appreciate, you know, the brethren across the country who are laboring in love to feed Yahshua's children. And to stand before His assembly is just a humbling, and just, I'm at awe just to have something to say. But, you know, to realize that Dr. Kinley, after having received this stupendous panoramic divine vision, and then as the previous speaker stated, Yahshua asked him, "Man, what will you do with that I've shown you?" He didn't know what to say.
That's right.
"I don't know."
That's right.
Then he said, "I'll show you." Then, according to Dr. Kinley's own testimony, Yahweh then gave him the revealed meaning of the vision. In other words, he received the revelation.
That's right.
of the panoramic vision that he beheld. And to help us understand how Yahweh could confirm and validate what we have in the scripture, he had a reference. And he was back here showing you how that these 73 that went up here, and you see it here, vision of Elohim.
Right.
And 1490, they had a vision. But see, and then when you see Moses here, mm-hmm. it says panoramic vision
right.
of Elohim. And we're able to learn that this is why Yahshua through the prophet Solomon, he said in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no prophetic vision, the people perish.
Right.
Because this vision that we are partaking of, it is a prophetic vision.
Mm-hmm.
This is how we're able to come in here and we're able to get Habakkuk, the second chapter,
mm-hmm.
and see how Yahweh answered Habakkuk and said, look, write the vision, make it plain upon tables,
right.
that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time,
right.
but at the end it shall speak and not lie. And Yahshua Messiah did not lie when he was tabernacling in the vessel of Henry Z. Kelly.
That's right.
That's why he said himself, Yahweh, according to his own testimony,
mm-hmm.
showed him how to illustrate. And he, like Dr. Kelly said, look, I'm not an artist. I couldn't draw. But Yahweh allowed vessels to come to him.
Right.
And he inspired them
right.
to illustrate
right.
what Yahweh had shown him. And then here's an illustration of the very first chart
right.
that was painted up. And look at the title of the chart. The chart is on the pattern or plan of salvation.
That's right.
So this school, which is set up to make ministers of the gospel,
mm-hmm.
and it's a school. We're not in church. We're in school.
That's
but the school was established to make ministers of the gospel.
That's right.
And not only to make ministers of the gospel, but to save our soul.
Mm-hmm.
And to give us the revelation of the vision.
Right.
So we see here, these people, they had a vision without a revelation.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so important that we have a revelation. Because we can look at them and see, without the revelation of the vision,
right.
look what they did.
Right.
They built a golden calf. They had the vision. They knew double well this right here didn't have no shape or form like this up here.
Right.
So here's a vision without an understanding. And then here's a vision on Moses' second principal trip. Here he sees the vision. Yahweh transformed the power of transmutation to take these attributes, organize them into a set pattern, and this is a spirit man.
Right.
And then this man, instantaneously, in the panoramic vision to Moses, transformed the power of transmutation.
There you go.
The power to take attributes from that state of invisibility and
go.
Just manifest them in another state of invisibility, but yet can be seen by divine vision, and then materialize them. That's why he said, Moses, let them make me a sanctuary that I might dwell among them according to all I showed you after the pattern of the tabernacle and after the pattern of all the instruments therein shall you make it.
Right.
So now here he's having an understanding or a revelation of the vision that he's receiving.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why Moses could tell them when he come down out of the mount that third trip, and he was lit up, and the Israelites couldn't even look on him. Moses had to put that veil over, which is a principle that we need to better understand. The veils, or that veil, to where Yahweh caused them to not be able to look at Moses. But what happened, Moses, he had an understanding. So it wasn't no problem for Moses to come down here and to instruct those Israelites. And then what you have in Exodus, the 25th chapter, get that for me, and probably, Exodus 31. Because listen, this tabernacle pattern that we can learn about, you see, the dimensions of it, we can learn about the anatomy of it, the physiology of it, or the operation of the priesthood, operating therein, he'll be able to come, look, listen, and learn something about the materialization of attributes in the form of a tabernacle. And we didn't know, the Israelites even didn't know, that this was a shadow of heavenly things.
That's right.
That's why Moses was admonished, back up a little bit, the 25th chapter, the 8th verse, he said, look, let them make me a sanctuary. And he went on and manifested the dimensions of the pattern, because 25:1, Yahweh told Moses, look, have those Israelites bring me some substance. The gold, the silver, the brass, blue, purple, scarlet, fine twine linen. And when you take the time to look those substances up, you're going to find out that it was 9 substances that went into the construction of the tabernacle. 9 substances. Why 9 substances? Because it's the 9 attributes. The 9 principal attributes that's organized into that set pattern. So like she said, the 9 substances made up the tabernacle. Then when it was constructed, then you had 9 principal vessels. They're in a 3-in-1 in the most holy place. So then that's why he was admonished. The 40th chapter, 25:40. Read it.
Exodus 25.
And look that thou make them after their pattern, which was showed thee in the mount. So we're able to come and sit, and then some students are able to go in dimensionally and to show how the dimensions of the pattern, those that were given for the various instruments, how that when you measure the cubits, you know, 18 inches, you're going to come out to the number 9. The number nine, you see? Because it's reflecting the 9 principal attributes of the Creator. That's why, what was that admonishment? And look at thou make them
After their pattern.
So
show thee in the mouth.
Show thee in the mouth. So when you dimensionally measure the brazen altar sin sacrifice, you're going to have that principal 9. When you, the golden altar table of showbread, the golden altar of incense, you see, you don't have to mention the lamps there, but and this ark of the covenant is going to come out to the principal 9, because it's the 9 primary attributes that Yahweh caused Yahshua through Dr. Kinley to identify the substance that he is. So the Apostle Paul on this side of the cross, after his revelation, being caught up to the third heaven, saw things unlawful for a man to utter. Now, in writing that letter to the Hebrews, can instruct them, Hebrews 8:5, that he doesn't come to the realization that, wow, Yahweh,
8:5.
This was a shadow of something, who served as an example.
Shadow of heavenly things,
the heavenly one.
As Moses was admonished.
Hey, guess what? We've been admonished. We've been admonished to come to class.
Yeah, that's right.
Be on time. Learn as much as we can learn.
Right.
Because we need it. And I just appreciate the admonishment that is given here in this school. To the point to where, look what Yahweh has given us. And I do it because the brother did it the other night. And that's why I appreciate the YouTube vehicle that Yahweh is giving us. Mm-hmm. Because you got people in remote places that cannot come to a class like this. If you're technologically sound, you got internet capability. Hey, log on. Yeah, this is a vehicle. We didn't have it when we first came in school. You see? But the admonishment now that Yahweh has given us is to do what? To read, to research, and then to rehearse. See, now I picked up that admonishment by watching y'all on YouTube. Okay? Because when I'm not working, I have that capability. Look, I can turn on my music channel and hear my smooth jazz or just do whatever I want to do. But Yahweh has given me an opportunity to where, look, on my same little telephone, I can log on to YouTube and I can look at a class 24/7.
Right.
And then the brother said, but the last R, is this right here. The revelation.
Mm-hmm.
See? That's Yahweh's responsibility.
That's right.
See, so we got something to read. We got the Bible. We got all kind of textbooks. The big textbook the founder wrote. We got the transcripts of his testimony in classes over the years that are transcribed from different students who were diligent in order to take those reel-to-reel recordings and the cassette recordings and to take the time to transcribe the lectures of the founder.
Mm-hmm.
So that we can read, we can research, because here's a sixth grader.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Man didn't even finish the sixth grade talking about inscrutability, incomprehensibility.
That's right.
And I tell you, the little sounds you might hear through me, it wasn't a part of my vocabulary prior to coming in here. Okay?
Yeah.
And I'm just grateful to be able to be a recipient of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because the thing of it is, these terms that we're learning is not describing any human being.
Right.
It's right. Describing the invisible, inscrutable, incomprehensible,
right.
Indiscernible, invisible. And there are so many other adjectives that we learn in here that reflects the creator of the universe.
Right.
So when we say that Moses, look, the admonishment was in 2440, but Paul went on this side of the cross and admonishing them Hebrews to let them know. In the 8th chapter of Romans and Hebrews, he is talking about, you see, that Yahweh, you see, what the beginning of the 8th chapter?
8 and 1. Now, of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum.
And now,
we
see,
have such an high priest who is set on the right hand
and
of the
things that we have spoken. Now, what we have to do is go back and just take the time like we were told. There was a time when those books were not broken up in chapters and verses.
That's right.
So what we need to do is take the time and just forget about chapters and verse and just read the whole book. It's 13 chapters. Just read it. But that's a message from Yahshua to those Hebrews. The book was written to the Hebrews. They were the ones that had the covenants. They were the ones that had the covenant relationship with the Creator. Yahweh, listen, at this mountain right here, Yahweh did not give them a religion.
That's right.
He didn't give them no religion at Mount Sinai. This was a covenant relationship established in types and shadows.
Mm-hmm.
Over here. See, this is why they had it read. Luke 24:44. Read it again. Then open he their understanding that they might understand the scripture. Hey, listen, our scripture lesson today, Job 28, read it again. Look at how many times you're going to see the term wisdom in that chapter today.
Mm-hmm.
Look how many times you're going to hear read the term understanding, which is the intelligence of Yahweh, who is Yahshua.
Right.
Understanding is Yahshua. That is him. That's what he said in Proverbs 8:14. You might want to put your finger on it. Because in Luke the 24th chapter, when he caught them up, elevated, he had appeared to them in another form. Look at how we're learning. Look, this illustration here. Death. Resurrection. Christianity says that's a physical body.
Mm-hmm.
But we come in here and the panoramic vision and revelation said, no, that's a spirit body. He's in another form that Mark talks about also. Like you say, Mark and Luke, they weren't walking around with Yahshua, but you're talking about the power of the Holy Spirit after the day of Pentecost. Mark being a companion of the Apostle Peter, Paul being a companion of Luke, you know, Yahshua quickening their understanding. That's what happens with us when we come into school through the preaching of the gospel. Our understanding is being illuminated. We're receiving of Yahshua, because that's what he said in Proverbs 8:14. Read it.
Proverbs 8:14.
Go back up and not read 8:12.
8:12.
Yes.
I, wisdom, dwell with proof.
He told you, Yahweh does not possess wisdom.
He is wisdom.
He is wisdom.
Right.
He does not possess understanding. He is understanding. Now, I said it. Why? Because I read it. His record is true. Read it, sweetie.
I, wisdom, dwell with prudence and find out knowledge of witty inventions.
Mm-hmm.
The fear of Yahweh is that hate evil.
That's right.
Pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the froward mouth do I hate.
Mm-hmm.
Counsel is mine.
Counsel, that's justice.
And sound wisdom.
And sound wisdom.
I am.
He told you that there's going to come a time when it will not endure sound doctrine.
That's right.
Paul admonished Timothy in that. Be mindful of that, Timothy. Because they are not going to endure sound doctrine.
Right.
And he says sound wisdom is whose?
Counsel is mine.
Counsel.
And sound wisdom.
Yes.
I am understanding.
I am understanding.
I
listen, that
strength.
Was not Solomon. Yahweh, listen. As this man said here, before the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit was using those men on assignments. He was just giving them assignments. The Holy Spirit was not universally poured out prior to Pentecost.
Right.
This man, under the influence of the Holy Spirit, listen, you read on down in Proverbs 8:22, we have that read. We're talking about Yahweh possessed being the beginning of his way.
That was his work.
King Solomon. Solomon was a man just like us, born through the loins of a woman of a few days and full of trouble. And you see, he got in trouble at the end of his life, going total contrary to what was expressed to him. You see, going at 300 women and 300 come on, bro. I didn't work like that. But see, Yahshua was just using them through types and shadows. But he said, I am understanding. Read.
I have strength.
Strength.
By
these
me.
Are the attributes. Strength.
By
Yahweh
me.
Does not possess strength. He is strength. This is why we told you in Exodus the 31st chapter, Yahweh, because this is going to be the standard of righteousness here.
Go ahead, bring it on.
And he's going to have them
there you go.
Construct something that's going to reflect him. Hey, he's not going to leave it to the master craftsman down here who helped build Pharaoh's treasure cities and Python and Ramesses. No, sir. He put, read it, Exodus 31 and 1.
Exodus 31 and 1. And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, I have called my name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah.
Yes.
And I have filled him with the spirit of Yahweh.
I have filled him with the spirit of Yahweh, Elohim, and the spirit of wisdom.
And in understanding.
And in intelligence, that's understanding.
And in knowledge.
And in knowledge.
And in all manner of workmanship.
So therefore, it's going to be perfection manifest in the natural. And we learn in this school, every aspect of the construction of this tabernacle was a manifestation of a principle pointing to Yahshua the Messiah.
That's right.
The high priest and the manner in which he was clothed upon in his garments of beauty and glory, dressed out to the nine, and when you count the clothing, his garments, it's going to come out to the number nine, just showing you the nine attributes that makes up Yahweh Elohim. And Yahweh was just not leading it to the carnal mind of man to construct this tabernacle. That's why for Paul way over here to say that this pattern was a shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, said he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed thee in the mount. So therefore, if he filled Aholiab and Bezalel with the spirit of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, that they might construct these vessels, then even the function that had to go on was important also. So when you go to that 25th chapter of Exodus, and you drop on down there, because I just want two things read, when you're talking about the construction, the composition, when you're talking about, because I heard the bell, the composition of the anointing oil, and the composition of the incense. Mm-hmm. Study those. Because Yahweh
gave specific instructions on the dimensions of these vessels,
yeah,
and also the measure, the amount
exactly
that was necessary. Because
right,
look, when you talk about, read real quick, because I got about 2 minutes. 25, where he's talking about the incense. It might be the holy anointing oil. It's going to talk about so many. That's correct. 25 and going down there. Or is it Exodus, the 30th chapter? My bad. Yeah, 30th chapter. We got the measurement of the anointing oil and the measurements and the ingredients of the incense. Because, see, Yahweh, listen, that anointing oil, which was a type of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
The Holy Spirit was not universally poured out before Pentecost.
Right.
So he used an anointing oil as a type and a shadow. But the way that oil was, you see, mixed and composed,
right,
it was done through the art of the apothecary, who was Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
He was the apothecary that told Aaron and Moses the amount to use. Read that.
30:22.
Yes.
Moreover, Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, take thou also unto thee principal spices.
Principal spices. We tell you, these are principal attributes.
Mm-hmm.
These are primary attributes.
Mm-hmm.
These are all the attributes of the Creator. But we realize that these are the principal attributes that other attributes emanate from.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Because, I mean, we just don't have the time to go into the gifts of the Spirit, which are attributes. The fruits of the Spirit, which are attributes. The precious promises of the Father, which are attributes that you have in 2 Peter, the first chapter. Those precious promises, that new nature of Yahshua that's supposed to be taken on shape and form in us.
Right.
And that old egotistical misdirected personality is killed through the preaching of the gospel. Then Yahshua the Messiah can resurrect. You know, and we're his workmanship, created in Yahshua Messiah for his glorification, not ours. That's why in that anointing oil, he say, look, in that incense, don't you even make none like it.
Right.
Because it ain't for you to smell good, look good. No, it's for Yahshua Messiah. He's the one that's going to be smelling good and looking good.
That's right.
That's right. He said, that anointing oil, look, don't even make none like that. Did he tell him that? Because
right,
it ain't for you, it's for him.
That's right.
And see, he was specific. Read that quick there, because I got about a minute.
Principal spices of pure myrrh, 500 shekels.
No, what about 499?
Mm-hmm. No, 500.
Mm-hmm. 500.
Well, can I do 501?
Nope.
He was specific.
That's right.
Because this is the standard of righteousness.
That's right.
Anything less than that is not righteous no more.
That's right.
And see, we got an example. I got 1 minute. Leviticus, the 10th chapter. Because it's going to tell you about
Aaron.
Two priests,
mm-hmm,
who were anointed.
Right.
They were washed. They were anointed. These two boys right here. They were anointed down here.
Leviticus 10 and 1.
Read it quick.
And then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron.
Who were they the sons of?
Aaron.
Aaron was the so-called high priest. You know Yahshua was the high priest back there, but he only used Aaron as a type. But Aaron was top dog, and his two sons.
Took either of them his censer and put fire therein, and put incense therein, and offered strange fire.
Strange fire.
For Yahweh, which he commanded them not.
Now look, see, you go back, and we didn't have it read. Well, you got the ingredients. Dr. Andre, Galbano, Frankenstein. Those were the ingredients. Those were the cheap, the spices. But he also told them how much. See, so it's not a matter of them not using the same ingredient. But it had to be to the exact amount.
Yeah, by weight.
Of course. For whatever weight he said, that's what it had to be done.
That's right.
But like the panoramic vision said, and many of you all probably heard Dr. Kennedy say, look, the boys offered up their own incense. Huh? Yeah. And what happened?
And then went out far from Yahweh and devoured.
And our Elohim is a consuming fire.
And they died before Yahweh.
So that's why it was so important for them to be obedient to the heavenly vision, and that has been, is now. That is to come, have already been.
Mm-hmm.
It's vitally important that we keep it just the way Yahshua the Messiah revealed it through you a panoramic vision and revelation.
That's right.
Because he said, without the revelation of the vision, he didn't know what to say. And that's why Yahshua in him said, teach my people your will. No, teach my people your will. Teach your people your will, Yahshua. That's what I read in the vision pamphlet. Now, if you didn't read that vision pamphlet, family that's out here in TV land, YouTube land, get the vision pamphlet. Read it yourself. And as we look at the vision expressed in chart form, look at what we have to read. Scriptural references, we can read. We can research. We can rehearse. And pray that Yahweh gives the understanding. Because he said he was understanding. That's why they had read in Luke the 25th chapter. When he took that and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scripture the things concerning them.
Himself.
No, the things concerning himself. Then it goes on to say, then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scripture. Yeah. They didn't understand until the day of Pentecost when he came in them as a fiery quickening spirit. And as they clove in tongues of fire, he lit them up. He lit their soul up. They was on fire. And the Apostle Peter, that wasn't Peter no more. Mm-hmm. That was Yahshua speaking through the mouth of Peter. Mm-hmm. And preached the gospel according to Yahshua, according to the law and the prophet. Read Acts the 7th and the 3rd and the 4th chapter. You'll see how Peter, you know, talking about Yahshua the Messiah, the power of his resurrection, and how David prophesied of him not having his soul in Sheol. And that sounds like the second bell. That's the second bell. Oh, man, I'm having just an edifying experience also. You know, because these charts, I'm just enveloped in all of these charts. I mean, it's just beautiful. But I'm just grateful to be, just to have a testimony. And just hope that something was said that could be of an encouragement, that could be of an, you know, an admonishment, inspiration to keep, continue to study with us. You know, and those that are here in Oceanside that are looking at us now, y'all need to be right here in school. Don't make this no excuse because you got YouTube. You see, come to school when you can. And then on the days that they don't have class, boy, boom, YouTube, here we go. Same way in Oceanside and everywhere else. Don't let YouTube be an excuse for you not coming to class. Because then in class, this is where your soul can be saved. YouTube, that's just give us something to do. Oh, let me write up. Because that's what I do. When I look at you all on YouTube and Oceanside, I follow you. I write my scriptures down. Mm-hmm. Then I go and check it out myself.
Right.
Then when I go to class in Orlando, and Yahweh puts something on my heart, then I can share it because I was inspired by the lectures that you guys have given. But I don't sit home and watch YouTube and don't go to school. Mm-hmm. No, because the founder, he said, come to this class. Right. Be regular in your attendance. Right. Learn all you can learn because you need it and you need it now.
Yeah.
So with that, glory. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Alrighty, thank you. Yeah, we really enjoyed the brother from Orlando. Okay, any announcements? No announcements? Okay, we have classes here Sundays, 11 to 1, Tuesdays, Thursdays, 7:30, 9:30. We have Spanish class every fourth Sunday of the month from 9:30 to 10:45. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now, is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with the presence of the glory, with exceeding joy. The only wise now of our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, be like glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever, as all say.
Amen.
Amen.
That was
good.
Zoom out and do that, Joe. Yeah, there you go.
Yes, indeed. Y'all did a beautiful job. I tell you, it was like a 1-2-3 punch. Hey, Marlon.
Yes, sir.
You coming down Saturday?
Yeah, I'm going to make you down.
We're going to have all these five folk here, and Joe's going to come, and we'd like to have you come.
and we're going to get...
We'll call work off then.
Okay.
I'll call work off. We'll make it happen.
Well, if you can, then we'd love to have you. I'll tell you, it's going to be fun.
Until Tuesday, we're actually staying in Ocean, but we'll be here until Tuesday morning. We should fly out to San Diego, which is
good. Yeah, their line is
going
to be through one little bar recording.
Garden hose is the word I was looking for.
Yes, that's exactly right.
She's doing okay.
She's doing
but she's still
getting our supply, which
Thursday we're going to remove the stable.
Next Thursday, right? Not this Thursday.
Next week.
Yeah, they use staple. When I cut my head, they use staple.
Oh, boom.
Yeah, it hurts.
They give you anesthesia too? Oh, no.
Yeah, or
It'll be on YouTube, don't worry. You can say anything. Hi, wave, whatever.
Hi, brethren.
Oh, Unity and Yah Symposium.
There you go. Yes. Come on with it.
2019,
August 1st through the 4th.
You can register, send us an email at unityandyah@gmail.com. That's unityandyah@gmail.com. If you need to call us, give us a call. Our phone number is 407-800-9105. Give us a call if you have any questions. It's $25 to register.
Come and make you work on Saturday too? On the Sabbath?
A little bigger. A lot of people don't pay attention to that, you know. But
yeah, I know.
Even at 5 o'clock, even at 7,
my wife will tell you,
you can't get on the floor.
There was no word that was wrong.
Before it goes,
what you got to do?
I don't know. I don't want to do it.